guide us, peace has tried us, hope inside us will lead the way on the road from greed to giving. Love will guide us through the night. If you cannot say though I may speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire and have not loved my words in vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Namaqua Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We're glad you're here. This is a Come As You Are congregation, and you are welcome here just as you are. I want to extend a special welcome to any visitors. Our visitors are gifts. We would love to stay connected, so please check in at the back table, and we can send you some communications. My name is Kathy Hartman, and I serve this amazing, truth-seeking, justice-loving congregation as a worship associate. As you may know, our minister, Reverend Dana, serves us just part-time, so you don't get to see her every week. Here at Namaqua, we foster a beloved community that celebrates diversity, strives for peace and justice, acts mindfully for the good of the planet, and inspires spiritual growth through a free and loving search for truth and meaning. We honor the ground we walk upon and acknowledge this land as the traditional and ancestral homeland of the Arapaho, Cheyenne, and Ute nations and peoples. We recognize and honor the indigenous peoples as original stewards of this land and vow to reconcile the deep wounds that still shape our world today. Few announcements. Next Sunday, June 16th, ta-da! The Sunday we've been waiting for 2 years. Our previous minister, Reverend Laurel Leifert, and our previous intern, Dr. Claire Hamour, are coming live to do the service with Reverend Dana next week, entitled Life Calls Us On. To those of you who don't know, there is a rule that when the minister leaves a UU congregation, we cannot have contact for 2 years. And it's 1 year for the intern. So this is a much awaited reunion. These are two very beloved people, and Francie, Laurel's partner, has been an integral part of our congregation. So we're all happy to see them. So a few things I need you to do this week. Contact Tam to see if you can be of any help, what she needs, or the day of the event, if you can volunteer, or just drop by my house and do some deadheading and pull a few weeds. Decide what you're bringing for the potluck. We'll be grilling meat and some non-meat items, and get your portable lawn chairs and bring those along. We have plenty of dinnerware, but we need chairs, so bring those along with you if you can. I would like you to drink lots of water and eat raw fruits and vegetables pretty much all this week, because we need to all lose a few pounds so we can fit everybody in here next week, okay? I think there's gonna be a lot of folks, and you know, we're gonna be tight, so. And it'll do us all good. And then show up on Sunday, starting your day with the only anti-rain dance I'll probably ever ask you to do, okay? All right, please take note of all the other events that are happening this week and this month on the calendar in your printed order of service. Note that the Pride Fest needs volunteers. Details can be found in the weekly email and in your order of service. We will be doing joys and sorrows a little later. If you have a brief personal joy or sorrow and you don't want to come to the mic, there are forms that the ushers can give you, and we can read those for you. Many, many thanks to everyone who's involved in today's service. It takes a small village, and we're always looking for volunteers in all capacities, so find your spot. Today we have two guests, but I'm going to introduce the one that's with our Half Plate organization this year. So Laura, if you'd like to come on forward, we've got the director of the Big Thompson Watershed Coalition. They are our May and June recipients, and she's going to give us a little yeah, you can come up here, Mara. That's great. A little information about what they do and why we should empty our wallets.
Hi, thanks for having me. I'm Laura Quattrini, the executive director of the Big Thompson Watershed Coalition. Mickey McGuire is one of your members, and he invited me here. I guess he nominated the coalition a couple of years ago for this donation, and so thank you, Mickey, for being a champion for our organization. Mickey was on our board for several years and is now an advisory person for myself. I started about a little over 2 years ago, and we were just about two people big. It was myself and one other staff person, and we were transitioning. For the first several years of the life of the organization, after the flood of 2013, we focused solely on flood recovery efforts, several projects along the river to make sure that ecological integrity of the river was incorporated into road repairs and all of the infrastructure repairs that happened all along Highway 34 and into the city. And we're still recovering from a lot of that flood damage. More recently, when I started, we started shifting into protection and building resiliency of the watershed. So, as you know, a lot of you were probably around for the Cameron Peak Fire that burned in 2020. And that is, wildfire is a real threat for our watershed. So that wildfire was the biggest wildfire in Colorado history. It burned over 208,000 acres, mostly in the Poudre watershed, but about 68,000 burned in our watershed, and we will be feeling the effects of that for many, many decades. It does affect our water quality. We have a lot of sediment and ash that are still flowing into our water systems, and so our organization helps to recover from that. For the last 3 summers have been working to implement projects, even with, you know, a couple of staff people. We also work to, build our wildfire resiliency. So we work with private landowners to implement forest thinning projects, but we also work in the city of Loveland implementing projects to build the opportunities to enjoy nature and really build the flood resiliency of, we work with the city of Loveland and other organizations. But anyway, we're working to build our capacity and offer opportunities for volunteerism. So this money that you're able to provide will help us really build that. Over the past 2 years, I've grown our organization from 2 to 4.5 people. So we're able to offer more opportunities to community members. And thank you so much for having me today.
Thank you, Laura.
You're fine.
So we'll be doing that obituary a little bit later. Now today we have a guest speaker. I only call him a guest because he hasn't been showing up much lately. Andy Carlson is part of this congregation and has been a worship associate in the past, well known for his erudite reflections and April 1st humorous services. He has a PhD in philosophy and is an historic building construction renovation specialist to pay the bills. Now a published author, we welcome him back.
Thank you, Kathy, and thank you all for inviting me back. As we enter into the spirit of worship today, let us keep the following thought in our hearts. There will always be times when things are bad. These will be followed by times when things get better. Even when life appears its darkest, we must believe in the light, for this belief can be a self-fulfilling prophecy. Our faith that tomorrow will be better than today can itself be the light that shines in darkness, driving the darkness away. Please now join me in reading our congregational affirmation.
Love is the spirit of this church, and service its call. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
And let us share the spirit of love by greeting those of us around you.
Give you a thumbs up when you can start the music.
Singing for our love.
Time for all ages. Do we have any younger folks who are with us here today? All right.
All right.
Okay. Thank you for joining me. Because I am going to need your help today. I would like to do some math problems. So They're pretty easy, so don't get too stressed out. Okay, let's start with just a super simple problem. What is 1 + 1?
2.
Very good. How about 1 + 1 + 1? 3, okay. It's getting a little harder. How about 1 + 1 + 1 + 1 + 1 + 1? 5, you got it. Okay, let's change things up a little bit. If you have 1 rock + 1 rock + 1 rock + 1 rock + 1 rock, what do you get? 5 rocks, there you go. Okay, yeah, well, stay tuned. Here's the last question. If you have 1 basketball player + 1 basketball player + 1 basketball player + 1 basketball player + 1 basketball player, what do you get? A team, there you go. All right. Sometimes it turns out 1 + 1 + 1 + 1 + 1 = 1. And the cool thing about this new 1 that we have is it can do things that no one player could do alone. They can throw passes, they can run plays, they can high-five each other, they can win basketball games. Sometimes when we all come together to make one, we can do things that none of us can do alone. And that new one, it could be your family, it could be your friend group, it could be a team you play on, your school, this church, the whole world. Sometimes as one, we can do what no one of us can do alone. So thank you for helping me with this lesson. I could not have done it alone. I think we're gonna sing you back to your seats because you're hanging out here today, so.
Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Let's light our chalice with this poem by Pat Uribe Lichty. We come together with our tired minds and bodies, with our confusion and questions, our uncertainties and our fears. We come together with our hopes, with our pasts and our ideas, our passions and our faith. We come together bringing all of who we are, trusting that in gathering we will be renewed, and that together we can create the world we long for. So we heard from Laura a little earlier, Laura Quattrini from the Big Thompson Watershed Coalition, and that is our half plate recipient for May and June. As you know, we share our contributions with, we have half goes into our budget, half goes to a nonprofit organization, and the Big Thompson Water Coalition is this month's and last month's. So if the ushers would come forward, and we'll get started with that. And yeah, I think Laura gave us a good overview of what they do, and give generously. Thank you. Service with our guests, but also to share what's going on in our lives. So if you would like to come up with a joy, brief personal joy or sorrow that you'd like to share, please feel free to come forward. There we go. Neither Andy nor I can carry a tune, so we gave the mic to Slip so that they could lead us in the songs. Now I have to figure out how to do this. Come on up.
I think I'll say. I got it. You're good. Come on up.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Jennifer Klein. And some of you know that the last few months I've had a couple of medical emergencies, and I'm doing much better now. But I wanted everyone to know that when your body is telling you something and you think you know it, you've got it covered, maybe you don't, and you ought to probably go and get somebody to catch it before it goes too far. So, but now Gary and I both have a certain amount of metal in our bodies, so we're going to cause problems to TSA when we go travel. So.
Thank you, Jennifer. We hold you in our heart, and it's a It's a good message. Yesterday, Nathan and I were at a memorial service for a good friend who was, I think, 67 years old. And his son came up to me very early in the service and he said, "My dad should have gone to the doctor." You know? So it's a great message for us all to remember that those little aches and pains sometimes might be more. Come on, Vicki.
I'm Vicki. This is too short for me. A lot of crud going on in our lives too, but I'm tired, sick and tired of talking about crud. So I want to talk about the reconnection I had this week, a couple of them that brought me a lot of joy. One was to have a former neighbor who's been gone now for 8 years. She moved back to Indiana, but she was back to visit us and spent 4 days with us. So that was absolutely marvelous. And then I've made a list of people that I've been wanting to reconnect with from my past. So yesterday I had a wonderful phone call with one of my former college roommates, and it was just, it was wonderful while it was happening, and it was just amazing afterwards how good it made me feel. So that's why I drug out my sparkly blouse this morning, because I'm tired of crud.
Oh yeah. We'll keep you in our hearts, and everyone else has got too much crud and can find the positive in all of that. Yeah. Speaking of. Hi, Sue.
Speaking of crud. Speaking of going to the doctor.
Yeah.
Speaking of having issues. Thank you all so much for holding me in your hearts. I had a rough time. I'm back, I think. Until something else gets me, but I don't know. You just have to take care of these temples. That's what I have found out. And you can't push it. And a lot of you have yelled at me. And thank you very much in your maternal way for yelling at me. I know it's from love. But I just want to say, when people ask me how I am, I almost always say, I'm great. It's just this damn body that isn't. But we're going to get there. And thank you all so much for your love. Don't hug me too hard today. We're still healing.
No, I meant going to the doctor. Sue, I think your problem, I'm going to diagnose you. You have too big of a heart. And we are going to hold you in our heart. And thank you for all you do for us. Nathan, did you want to come and say something?
Hi, I'm Nathan, and yesterday we had the opportunity to see four moose.
And one of them was?
A baby.
How long do you think he was on this planet for so far?
Probably since yesterday.
He was just born yesterday, yep.
Yeah, still kind of had his leg, and that was pretty fun to watch.
Yeah, he was real wobbly, wasn't he? Yeah, it was great. We had a great visit from my sister-in-law and brother-in-law in Albuquerque, and so we just took them, you know, down the canyon. We didn't know what we were going to do, and we ended up at Lily Lake and stepped out down by the lake, and three moose immediately. And when we went to look, there was the baby, and it really was newborn. It was unbelievably special. Anyone else have a joy, or anyone on Zoom? We're good. So everything's in recovery, and we're joyful. And Sherry, did you want to say something? Okay.
Good morning. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces and new faces. But how about that? Oh, I can hear the difference. Okay. I had the most amazing experience just in the last 24 hours or so. I didn't know anything about a soup kitchen. I'd never helped serve meals or done anything with the homeless. And belonging to this community, I thought, you know, I need to start trying some of these things because maybe it's a good fit and maybe I can help. So I went with my granddaughter, Avery, who's back there and sitting back there in the back. we went together, and it was the most amazing experience watching her at the age of 10 reach out to these people. She put the apron on, got the gloves on, and just said, "What can I do?" And we worked in the dining room, and she served them. I poured the drinks, and she took it to the table, and then she'd visit with them. And then she'd come back and fill up the dessert trays, and we'd go around with those. But she was so comfortable. She was so comfortable that I learned a huge lesson to just give and serve. And there's a connection there no matter where people come from. And I have my granddaughter to thank for the depth of what I experienced because of how she took it on and handled it and so beautifully and lovingly. And she said, "Nana, I'm not stage fright anymore." When she comes to church and she's asked to do something, she doesn't have stage fright anymore. So hopefully you'll see more of her.
Oh, good. Well, we hold you both in our hearts and thank you for being of service to us and to others.
And Avery was our bell ringer today. She's just, we love it when the kids come up and ding, ding. I just want to share with you, Bill and I are part of the tech team. Katie Fox, she heads up the tech team now. And we came into work today with a thank you note. It says, "Thank you, Namaqua, you volunteers and staff. We love you." I have no idea who wrote this hand note. It says, "Zoom and audio tech, thank you for all you do. Every week you are appreciated for making sure the service can be heard and seen on Zoom and that we all can sing along and enjoy all the pieces that make our Sundays lovely." I don't know who wrote this, but that's the kind of congregation we have. Love anonymously. It's amazing. Thanks.
Yeah, we hold that tech team in our hearts deeply because we couldn't do this without them. So thank you.
I'm kind of curious. I don't know for sure what's going on, but I noticed this morning in the newspaper that Bernice Kwan died. And I don't know whether you guys remember that she was a member of this congregation. So if anybody's got any information, I'd like to know, and maybe you can pass it on. Thank you.
We held her family in our hearts and those of you who were connected to her also. Anyone else?
Oh, okay.
Okay, ma'am, what's going on?
At 4 p.m. Friday, I lost my house. But I'm still here. And I'm glad you guys are here. That's it.
Okay. Thanks, ma'am. We hold you in the heart. That's a big, big transition, big change, big loss.
Yeah.
Well, for those and all the other ones that are too tender to be spoken, and for those people who are suffering around the world in so many different places, we hold them in our hearts, and we will keep them in our hearts through this week and beyond. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you once again for inviting me back to Namaqua. I know it's been a few years, but as some of you probably have heard by now, I've spent quite a bit of this time writing a book called The Progressive Worldview. The hardback edition is 470 pages, so I can't tell you about the whole thing right now, but I would like to talk about the most obvious question that its title raises. What is the progressive worldview? We're in a UU church, so I'm going to guess that many, though perhaps not all of you, would identify as progressives. What does that mean? When we're asked this question, we're usually thinking in political terms. So most often we'll list some of the key political issues of the day and note where we stand on them. As progressives, for instance, we are for LGBTQ rights, we are against racial discrimination, we support reproductive freedom, we are against oppression in all its forms. Defining progressivism in this way is fine. In fact, at a time when our progressive values are being aggressively challenged, we should be shouting them from the rooftops. Still, this political characterization of progressivism is not what interests me most. Or rather, I should say that as someone who was originally trained in philosophy, the question that interests me is, what is the deeper philosophy that has led us as progressives to adopt these political stances? Or to go back to my original question, what is the progressive worldview? Let's start with the easier question, what is a worldview? Clearly enough, it is a way of viewing the world, or a way of making sense of the world around us and our experience of it in the broadest possible fashion. A related term you often hear today is belief system. In any case, a look back at history shows that over the millennia, different cultures have understood the world in some very different ways. More precisely, every culture of which we know has had its own foundational narrative, or a story about our world that addresses four key questions. Where does the world come from? Where is it headed? How does it operate? And what is the place of human beings within it? Back when I first started thinking about worldviews, I realized one of the most telling ways we can compare and contrast different worldviews is by focusing on the second question, where is the world headed? Or by asking about the trajectory a particular worldview ascribes to the world and its history. Most ancient worldviews were cyclical in character. This makes sense given how closely ancient people lived to nature, and nature is filled with cycles, daily, monthly, annual, even generational cycles of light and dark, warmth and cold, birth and death, joy and sorrow. So most ancient foundational narratives assumed that history repeats itself endlessly without ever actually going anywhere. The Vedic tradition, for instance, which arose in ancient India and ultimately spawned such religions as Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Taoism, often portrays the world as a giant wheel. Sometimes things go up and life gets better. Inevitably, however, the wheel of life turns and drags things back down, ultimately bringing the world right back to where it started. If the ancient conception of time was therefore generally cyclical, a small group of Semitic tribes wandering the Middle Eastern desert pioneered a new way of viewing time, as linear, or as moving forward without then repeating itself. Think about the foundational narrative contained in the Torah, better known to many of us as the Christian Old Testament. The story still has some cyclical elements, but sometimes things happen that change the world forever, leaving the past never to be repeated again. My favorite example of this comes in the book of Genesis, when Adam and Eve eat the apple and get kicked out of the Garden of Eden. God then posts an angel with a flaming sword at the gates of Eden, making clear that there is no return to paradise. There's no going back to the way things were before. History has rather begun a new chapter, and from here, it can only move forward. I mentioned that the Hebrew narrative still bears some echoes of the older cyclical traditions, and we can see this particularly insofar as the people of Israel go through many ups and downs over time. They are taken into captivity, they are freed. They are taken into captivity again, they are freed again. So while the Hebrew narrative does keep moving forward, it kind of moves in squiggles. It does not have a single overriding vector. That would first come with an offshoot branch of Judaism that latched on to the teachings of a renegade prophet named Jesus, particularly once medieval Christian theologians had reinterpreted the original Hebrew story in a new light. The most important of these theologians was Augustine, Bishop of Hippo, and author of the Doctrine of Original Sin. As Augustine read the book of Genesis, when Adam sinned, he did not just do one thing wrong when he ate the apple. Rather, by defying God, Adam took on a sinful state. And as he and Eve then started having children, he passed this sinful state down to his kids, which they passed down to their kids, and so on. All of us have therefore inherited Adam's original sin, the main effect of which is that we cannot help but keep committing further sins of our own. And thus the world just keeps sinking ever deeper into sin. Traditional Christianity, in other words, adopted a declinist worldview, with history pointed in a single direction, forward but down. The world began in a golden age, things were great, but then something went wrong, and things have been going downhill ever since. And that is why, on the traditional Christian view, our only real hope for the future lies beyond the current world, in a heavenly realm we can reach only with the help of divine salvation. Indeed, according to the Christian story, God will eventually destroy the world around us and build a new Jerusalem, since left to its own devices, our world would just keep going downhill. This declinist worldview dominated European culture for 1500 years, and that is one reason why learning, and particularly learning about nature, slowed to a crawl over this period. The material world is just a cesspool of sin that is destined to be destroyed any day. Why bother studying it? Around the start of the 17th century, however, cracks began to appear in this worldview. This was the time of the scientific revolution. For centuries, European culture had insisted that if you want to learn the truth of things, you should listen to the voice of authority, whether the authority in question was the king, the pope, or God himself. But then a bold group of natural philosophers, folks like Francis Bacon, Galileo, Descartes, and Isaac Newton, resolved to start pursuing the truth in a new way, by trusting their own powers of reasoning. And the new approach worked. The newly formed modern sciences suddenly began to yield huge troves of knowledge. And as the ancient Hebrew scribes might have said, things were never the same again. Early in the 18th century, the loose intellectual movement known as the Enlightenment came together, and many of its proponents, inspired by the sudden progress being made in the natural sciences, performed the following calculation. The world, as modern science was showing, is a rational system governed by certain unchanging universal laws of nature. Human beings are rational creatures. If we use our powers of reason, therefore, we can start discerning nature's laws. And once we understand the laws by which nature operates, we should be able to start reshaping nature to better meet our human wants and needs. We can start making the world better over time. We can make progress. We can do so, moreover, not by relying on help from beyond, but through our own efforts, and first and foremost, through the use of our reason. And thus was born the progressive worldview. That's a distinctly modern way of viewing the world that regards history as pointed forward and up. Looking back over the past few centuries, we can see that the optimism with which Enlightenment philosophers began to view the future was well justified. If anything, they underestimated the amount of progress humankind would soon begin to make. Most obviously, the scientific revolution spurred a whole series of technological revolutions, and together these have lifted the vast majority of the world's population out of the grinding poverty that was the human lot for millennia. Today, not only have average global incomes soared to a historically unprecedented levels, but we can purchase goods that would have been not just unavailable to even the wealthiest of medieval kings, but unimaginable, ranging from indoor plumbing to airline flights to iPhones. Of course, this rapid technological advance has had certain downsides, leading to such current problems as climate change. On balance, however, we can hardly overstate the degree to which the average quality of human life has improved over the past three or four centuries. Nor is it merely in the scientific and technological realms that the modern world has made progress. Enlightenment thought further drove major advances in how we organize and govern ourselves, with the common thread holding these various forms of progress together being the idea of universal law. Modern science, again, rests on the notion that nature is governed by certain universal laws, such as the law of gravity, that apply equally to every body in the universe. That inspired Enlightenment thinkers like Thomas Jefferson to put forward an even more radical proposition, that all people are equal by nature, thus implying that the laws we institute to govern ourselves should treat all people in equal fashion. This flew in the face of what everyone had believed for millennia. It had long been assumed that kings rule because they are regal by nature, while slaves and peasants serve because they are servile by nature, thus justifying the steeply hierarchical political systems that characterized virtually every pre-modern society. But when Jefferson and his fellow colonists had freed themselves from the tyranny of British rule, they resolved to design a new system of government that would allow people to govern themselves, giving everyone an equal say and how the society is run. Of course, we know the American founders failed to live up to their own moral aspirations in many ways. Jefferson himself owned slaves until the day he died. Americans of European descent continued to decimate the Native American population. And American men continued to do what men of virtually every culture had always done, dominating and subjugating the women in their lives in every way imaginable. Still, for everything the American founders got wrong, they got one thing right: the ideal they set for themselves, the ideal of universalism. And since the ink began to dry on the Constitution, this ideal has provided progressively minded thinkers and activists of every demographic stripe with their moral North Star as they have worked to make the ideal of universalism more of a reality. So even as this moral progress was unfolding over the past 2.5 centuries, often quite slowly and painfully, modern science was continuing to race forward. Notably, in the middle of the 19th century, Charles Darwin introduced his theory of evolution. Then in the early 20th century, Albert Einstein helped launch a second revolution in physics the produced relativity theory and quantum mechanics, ultimately leading cosmologists to propose a new account of our world's genesis, a story that began with a colossal explosion nearly 14 billion years ago. And thus, if we take these scientific developments together with many others, we find that a new foundational narrative has emerged over the past few hundred years, a modern, empirically based story of where our world came from, where it is headed, how it operates, and what the place of human beings is within it. And what is perhaps most striking is that the more we have learned about this story, the more we have come to realize that progress is not just a human phenomenon. Rather, the story of our entire universe has been a story of progress from the very beginning. A bit of reflection shows, moreover, that much of this progress has taken the same form. Most generally, we can say that the progress our world has made over time has involved many smaller, simpler parts coming together to form larger, more complex wholes. This variety of progress began shortly after the Big Bang, when the early universe had cooled enough for quarks to start coming together to form electrons, protons, and neutrons. These subatomic particles then started binding together to form larger atoms of hydrogen and helium, while gravity drew huge numbers of these atoms together to create giant gas clouds. When some of these gas clouds then collapsed under their own weight to form stars, the fusion reactions raging within them fused lightweight hydrogen and helium atoms together to form larger, heavier atoms, such as oxygen, carbon, and iron. Accordingly, when the first generation of stars finally burned out, some of them exploding and strewing their contents across space, this seeded the next generation of stars with heavier elements, leading many of them to form entire solar systems that included such solid bodies as comets, meteors, and planets. On at least one of these planets, the movement from smaller and simpler to larger and more complex then began again, as carbon atoms organized themselves into larger organic molecules, which themselves joined together to form amino acids and proteins. And when certain globs of these organic compounds learned how to reproduce themselves, life was born. Life began as tiny single-cell organisms, but over time it evolved into larger, more complex, more sophisticated organisms, ultimately to include a clever, curious primate that one day decided to leave the safety of the trees behind and start walking the African savanna on two legs. Over the 6 million years since this time, our early ancestors only got smarter, eventually tripling the size of their brains, thus allowing Homo sapiens to develop the unique capacity that philosophers would one day call human reason. As our ancestors were making this physiological progress, they were also making social progress, again following the similar pattern of moving from smaller and simpler to larger and more complex. For most of human prehistory, our ancestors lived in small tribes of migratory hunter-gatherers. But then around 10,000 years ago, some of them used their powers of reasoning to invent domestic agriculture, and people began gathering in permanent settlements, first small villages, then larger and more complex towns, then city-states, kingdoms, finally empires. As I mentioned before, virtually every one of these pre-modern societies organized themselves in steeply hierarchical fashion, with very small groups at the top dominating and subjugating the rest of the society. Only around 400 years ago did the founders of the progressive tradition strike upon the idea of viewing and treating everyone as moral equals. Again, the first of these attempts were highly imperfect. Nonetheless, our society has made substantial and meaningful moral progress since this time. And this progress has again taken its familiar form of moving from smaller and simpler to larger and more complex. To explain, let's go back to the founding of the United States. As we know, the demographic group that had always dominated society, white men, remained in charge. But this group did take a revolutionary leap forward when they began treating one another in more or less equal fashion while adopting a democratic form of government. Now, instead of a tiny group ruling the rest of the society, a much larger group had begun to govern themselves. That said, white men as a group did continue to dominate and subjugate every other demographic group. So what we would call the social in-group, or the group that determines how the entire society is run, was somewhat larger than before, but still relatively small and homogeneous. Slowly, however, this began to change as one traditionally marginalized group after another has been drawn into the social in-group, thus expanding the circle of those invited to share in the self-governance of the larger society. Rocky as this progress has been, it has rendered our current social in-group much larger, more diverse, more gloriously complex than anything history has ever seen before, with the ultimate progressive goal being to one day draw everyone into the circle of inclusion while excluding no one. Of course, this work is not yet done, but what the progressive worldview has come to tell us is that when we dedicate ourselves to this work of social justice, we are not just doing politics. At the same time, we are participating in a story of universal progress that began nearly 14 billion years ago and has been unfolding ever since. We are actively weaving our lives into the interconnected web of all existence by consciously steering our actions in the same direction the universe has always pointed, forward and up. And thus, in helping our world take its next step or two forward, we are endowing our own small, short lives with a meaning as large and as enduring as the universe itself. May it be so.
As we extinguish the flame on our chalice, we ignite it inside ourselves. Our commitment to our mission and to one another is an unquenchable flame. Let us remember that we are not alone until we light this flame next time. May it be so. Thank you all. Let's get together for coffee and conversation in Parker Hall.